Thank you for the opportunity to be able to join you and to address you on a topic which I have chosen from amongst the four topics that were put before this international conference, this annual conference. If you look at the program, there were actually four topics which speakers were invited to choose to address the audience. One of them was the global migration crisis, and we've just heard a very interesting presentation regarding migration. And I come from an island in the middle of the Mediterranean, the southernmost tip of the European Union. We are literally there in the middle of the corridor, so I know exactly how serious the problem is, how challenging it is, and how important it is for the future of the European Union. The second topic was Ukraine, Syria, and NATO. The third was global human rights. And the fourth is the United Kingdom, Brexit, and the European Union. Now, I have chosen to talk basically about this fourth topic. But let me make two statements before I start my speech. First, I'm not going to question the decision taken by the British people. I mean, once I make a statement that I am fully in favor of the democratic process, the very first thing I need to do is accept that there is a decision, even though I disagree with that decision. But I bow in front of the democratic process that led to that decision. The second thing is, and it was interesting listening to a number of speeches, is that there is a connection between one topic and another. For example, the topic you've just been addressed about a few minutes ago about migration was for sure very high on the agenda of the Brexit referendum. So when we're talking about the decision by the British people in the referendum, it is clear that amongst the list of items that shifted the balance in favor of remaining in the European Union, leaving and remaining, well, there was the migration issue. And by the way, let us understand once and for all, because we keep talking just as if this was a European phenomenon. It is not just a European phenomenon. This is a global phenomenon. And using the same point I was making earlier, if you look at the outcome of the presidential election in the United States, with President-elect Trump, it is also obvious that even there, the decision with respect to the choice of Trump, in that decision, the American electorate was weighing the issue of migration. In that case, it was mainly migrants from Mexico, and that was also on the agenda. If you go to Australia, you will understand that even in Australia, the issue of which party is elected includes a very important aspect as well, which is migration. So the link of migration with all these political upheavals that are taking place, and also with the political reality which we are surrounded by, with the issue of populism or populist or whatever label we want to give, all of these are interrelated with each other. So, I have chosen to dedicate the speech to the topic dealing with, indirectly with the European Union and the future of the European Union. Janša addressed a particular aspect of that challenge. But the European Union in the light of Brexit and the analysis, I will attempt to analyze why was this decision taken? What led to this decision? And I do this simply to try and understand what we need to do. The analysis is not just a pastime. We don't do it just because we are curious to find out why did the British decide in that way. It's not about curiosity at all. It's about trying to identify where are the challenges and what, therefore, do we need to do for the future. So as I said, I do so because, in my opinion, the outcome of the UK referendum represents a challenge to the political, economic, social, and cultural status quo, which the Western world seems to have taken for granted for so many years. We've lived with this, we've enjoyed it. It's brought enormous benefits to all of us. But for some reason, now that has been challenged. That status quo has been challenged, and challenged in a very dramatic way. In fact, I personally look at the result of the Brexit referendum, but also at the result of the presidential election in the United States. I look at them as actually a call by the electorate, a statement by the voters. This is not merely an outcome which happened to take place, but the electorates of these countries decided to make a very clear statement. And we need to understand what that statement is. Because in my opinion, what they are telling us is, hang on, you politicians who were responsible throughout all these years, you were in government, you were the traditional parties. You used to tell us about the common good. You used to tell us about the fair distribution of wealth. Where is the fair distribution of wealth? And what has happened to the common good? So the Brexit issue is therefore important for all of us. It is important also, by coincidence, for my country, because Malta, the smallest member state of the European Union, presides the European Council, the Council of Prime Ministers, the top body of the European Union, starting from the 1st of January. Malta is now, for the next 6 months, presiding the Council of the European Union. All of this concerns us Maltese directly, because we will be presiding the European Union precisely when probably the negotiations for Brexit will start to take place. So it is of major interest for us, but more importantly, it is of major interest for all those who embrace the European values. I've heard some statements by some speakers before me saying, well, you know, sometimes speaking about values in today's world doesn't really ring well in the popular sentiment. Well, I don't know. I keep saying that the strength of the European Union is actually in the values that it represents and that brought the European member states together after the Second World War, because it was a reaction to the horrors of the Second World War, and we seem to have forgotten all of that. So I do speak in my country, and whenever I can, in the international occasions I have, I do speak about the value of solidarity. I do speak about the value of solidarity. But value of solidarity, however, is not just a value which one throws it up and uses it according to the circumstances. Is the value of solidarity when faced with the migration problem? Is the value of solidarity when faced with the homeless? Is the value of solidarity when faced with those who have lost their jobs? I am also a very, very staunch supporter of the value which is universal, not just European, but universal, but the respect for human rights, the true respect for human rights, whatever the color of the skin, whatever the place of origin of the individual, whatever the age, whatever the health, because we have no right to speak about human rights if, when faced with an immigrant, we decide to shut the door or let that immigrant drown in the middle of the Mediterranean. What right do we have to speak of human rights when we just turn a blind eye to the tragedies that we've seen in the jungle at the outskirts of France and whatever? So, also of particular relevance to this institute, to the Institute of Cultural Diplomacy, the statement which again sounds so beautiful. So cultural diversity and the beauty of unity in diversity. What a lovely statement. Is that true? Is it true? Do we really believe this? When if you walk out in whatever country you are in the European Union, you'll find ghettos, areas where exclusively immigrants who have happened to find themselves either officially recognized as refugees or not refugees, living in a particular area, completely cut off from the rest of the community in that particular town or village? So unity in diversity, is this unity in diversity? Or is it division, literally, stark, clear division, which we are seeing happening amongst us? Again, and this is the Europe of values. This is the project that was so beautiful when it was first launched after the Second World War. So from my point of view, therefore, Brexit needs to be placed within this context, and it needs to be placed within a wider context that embraces global and European events that are both that happened both before, during, and even after Brexit itself. If you look at this, if you analyze exactly what led, the months that led, and the years that led to Brexit, but then also what happened after and what happened in different parts of the world, I think you will notice that there is a pattern to all of this. There is a pattern to these events. Now, I was reading recently, I don't know if you've ever heard of him, Jonathan Sachs. Jonathan Sachs is a well-respected Jewish rabbi. He was the one who inspired Tony Blair with the famous Third Way. And he makes some fantastic speeches and has some very excellent publications. Well, in his analysis of what happened in Britain because of Brexit, he described the outcome, he described the experience as one where there is a politics of rage, anger. The rage and anger of a people who feel disenfranchised and betrayed by politicians who have allowed globalization to run wild, generating injustice, unemployment, greed, and most importantly, unfair distribution of wealth. In his article titled Beyond the Politics of Anger, which was published in the Daily Telegraph a few weeks ago on the 11th of November of this year, Jonathan Sachs states this, and I quote, "This is not politics as usual. The American presidential election, the Brexit vote, and the rise of extremism in the politics of the West are warnings of something larger, and the sooner we realize it, the better. What we are witnessing is the birth of a new politics of anger. It is potentially very dangerous indeed." This analysis by Sachs is echoed in another article, this time written by the famous theoretical physicist Stephen Hawking, of all people, Stephen Hawking. It was published in The Guardian a few days ago, on the 1st of December. Hawking's article is titled, "This is the most dangerous time of our planet." In it, he makes the following statement, and I quote again. "Whenever we might think about the decision by the British electorate to reject membership of the European Union and by the American public to embrace Donald Trump as their next president, there is no doubt in the minds of commentators that this was a cry of anger by people who felt they had been abandoned by their leaders." So the question is inevitable. How in heaven's name could a project, once we look at the European Union, a project for peace born 60 years ago as a result of the Treaty of Rome, putting forward an answer to the horrors of two world wars, a project that has proven able to bring lasting political stability in the European continent, notwithstanding the diversity of cultures, histories, economic achievement, language, and a host of other differences, how could this project, 60 years down the line, create anger amongst its electorate, amongst its voters? What, if I may ask, are we or have we been missing? What are we missing in this picture? Why this anger? Now, very often, I am one of those who believe that often it's a simple answer rather than a complicated analysis of different reasons. And it is obvious, even to casual observers, that the concerns underlying these popular or populist choices derive from the inescapable conclusion that globalization and accelerating technological changes have brought widening economic inequality around the world. This is magnified by the fact that we are all witnessing this injustice in real time every time we surf the internet or we switch on the television or go on our Facebook or receive some message. Every single day we get this picture being presented to us. We have millions of our citizens who have lost their jobs. Those who have lost their homes and their life savings. Those millions who have seen their pension cut by one third, if not by half, yesterday. Anyone switching on the television would have seen the pensioners protesting in Greece. You know, because their pension has been cut in half. Millions who have seen their quality of life reduced to an unbearable level. Those European citizens who have seen their teenage sons and daughters frustrated because they are unable to find a job, notwithstanding their university qualifications. Okay, so who can blame the electorate for being angry? They are not the only ones, of course. The anger of the electorate is not just those who have been hit by this, who have lost their homes or whoever. Those who have been lucky enough to escape the worst of this crisis are still scared stiff of becoming themselves victims of these same circumstances. The sense of insecurity, inevitability, and fear of what the future might offer to us and to our children and grandchildren must inevitably generate a sense of insecurity, fear, and anger at those who some have described as the elites. You must have come across this term, which is becoming part of the language when criticizing the political families. The elites, or better still, a word which is also becoming very popular, the establishment. It is the fault of the establishment. It is the fault of Brussels. It is the fault of the government. It is the fault of the minister, the prime minister, or whoever. All of whom are perceived as having failed to deliver what they had promised. The manner in which we respond to these challenges will be crucial for the future of the European Union, for the future of Britain, for the rest of the world. Stephen Hawking argues that we would all be committing a terrible mistake if we decide to reject these voices simply as outpourings of crude populism that fail to take account of the facts. The worst thing we could do is, well, you know, these are just the populists who are taking advantage of the situation. That's the worst we could do. The facts prove that we have an economic model that often fails the majority of our families, mainly because of unfair income distribution. In a world where globalization should have benefited us all, we now know that there are only a very few privileged who have become extremely rich, extremely wealthy, whereas the vast majority of our citizens feel that they have been sidelined and that they are not benefiting in the world that's being created. And by the way, I've heard somebody saying that globalization is finished. Globalization is not finished. It will not finish because globalization is the end result of technology. It is the collapse of all the barriers. It is the fact that from the comfort of your kitchen, you can compete with your financial services which in a country which is 1,000 miles away from your home. That is what globalization is. And even Britain, even though most of the electors in the British referendum voted because they are not happy with the globalization and they want to move out of the unit which is known as the European Union, yet their leaders themselves say, well, we will negotiate bilateral agreements with all the different countries now. But that's another form of globalization. You're going back to having to deal with economies and markets of different countries. This is the reality. So if globalization is there, and there's no way we're going to escape it because technology will not allow us to escape it, what should we do? Should our answer be a reversal of globalization? Should our new economic model be based on one that focuses on building barriers, tariffs, introducing new obstacles between nations? Should we translate, putting it differently, cultural diplomacy into a tool that distinguishes cultures by emphasizing the differences instead of giving value to the diversity as humanity's most precious asset? I will not offer any perfect solutions to these soul-searching questions, but I find myself amongst those who believe that solutions can only be found if we accept the inescapable realities that surround us today. Namely, jobs and industries will continue to disappear because of technology. Nothing is going to stop technology. We're not going to put the clock back. So automation, robotics, will obviously mean loss of jobs. It has happened in the past, but we have found solutions in the past by diversifying, by coming up with different solutions, by incentivizing entrepreneurship, by investing into education that creates innovation. We must therefore respond by investing more in training our human resources for this new world we are living in, for them to be able to change and adapt according to the needs of a modern society. Of course, our economic model must be one structured around the technology platform that surrounds us. But it must also respond to the need to invest profits into training and educating our workforce. One that eliminates gender discrimination and similar prejudices. One that penalizes industries that exploit the weak and the vulnerable. One that stops the barefaced abuse of third world countries simply because their workers are forced to work under inhuman conditions and at ridiculously low wages because they have no alternative but to do so. A globalized economy that understands the need to guarantee a minimum wage to its workers that is fair and reasonable. One that redresses the inequality in income distribution. One that encourages investment into the training and retraining of its workforce, and one that truly respects the dignity of every human being, whether living in the industrial heartland of Britain, the Rust Belt in the USA, or the slums of a third world country. I will conclude my speech to you by again quoting what Hawking said in his article. He said, if communities and economies cannot cope with current levels of migration, which is considered to be one of the reasons for the loss of jobs in some countries, then, he says, we must do more to encourage global development, as that is the only way that the migratory millions will be persuaded to seek their future at home. In other words, the solution for these challenges is for us to face the realities around us and to invest into the development of human resources. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a very thought-provoking talk on the lessons of Brexit and the politics of anger, which you refer to. I'm sure that there are many who want to put questions to you, but I think we only have time for two. So,
thank you. I have very good memories from the time you were Prime Minister in Malta, and I still bear in mind our discussions then. I would like to ask you a couple of questions that would address the Brexit itself. By the time you were Prime Minister, have you ever organized a referendum?
Yes, of course.
On which topics?
Well, we had the referendum precisely to join the European Union.
Okay.
And we had another referendum on the issue of the introduction of divorce.
Fine.
So, this is true, I'm not joking. So,
I would leave the latter aside. But as for the former,
yes,
like in all members of the European Union, new members of the European Union, the constitution had to be amended, and that was through a referendum.
Yes.
The problem is that today referenda have become a perversion to the regular and normal mechanism of democracy. Mm. It's very easy to organize referenda. on topics where the answer would be absolutely positive. Whoever wants to work, whoever wants to pay taxes. It's so easy. Prime Minister, why did a referendum of this kind happen in the UK?
Well, there are obviously different answers for different circumstances. There is an argument that describes the need of referendum, the promise by David Cameron to introduce the referendum as a political need he had in order to resolve a particular situation within the Conservative Party, you know? On the other hand, in Malta's case, the referendum we had to join the European Union was because we were divided. The country was divided. There was the opposing party, today in government, by the way, because this is the irony, the party that opposed Malta's membership in the European Union tooth and nail and lost the referendum is today in government. And as from the 1st of January, we'll be presiding the European Union. So you see the irony of politics. But I need to point this out, because I think if we are going to judge referenda on the outcomes, I think we would be betraying the values of democracy. The referendum itself is perhaps the best example where the electorate is free to express a position on an issue. In a general election, usually it's a manifesto with 101 different proposals, whereas a referendum is very often focused on one particular issue. So I would caution very much about this sense of skepticism with respect to the referendum model. I maintain that democracy, after all, is not something that is linked exclusively to the outcome of a general election when people go to vote. It is not just that gives you the model of democracy. So I would say I remain in favor of referenda. I would say the referenda need to be well prepared, and the general public needs to be well informed. So there are a lot of conditions. But I still maintain it is an important tool of a democratic process. And we should not, because we disagree with some outcomes that have taken place, another one in Italy just a few weeks ago, we should not automatically then consider all referenda as being a wrong choice in the political tools that we have. I think, on the contrary, it is an important part of the democratic process.
Thank you very much, Mr. Excellency. My name is Zalant from Kabul, Afghanistan. My question was to the previous speaker, but as you have also discussed the migrant issue and one of the biggest issues, so it relates to somehow to the migration problem. I think it's more or less the cause and effect theory. The migration that is coming to Europe as Afghans is the second or the first biggest migrants to Europe. It's all because of the cause of the war that has been imposed on Afghanistan. There is a very famous book, Why Nations Goes to War. Why Nation Goes to War talks about 20th century all wars. And it says that anybody who has invaded during the 20th century, they lost the war. The US America, the US Vietnam War, the Soviet Afghan War, they have lost. And also the First World War and Second World War, Somalia War, many other wars. Here, the writer discusses from 1900 to 20th, all the wars. In all those wars, the invaders has lost. The 21st century, unfortunately, started also with invasions. Invasion on Afghanistan, invasion on Iraq, invasion on Syria, invasion on Libya. And that has caused migrants flow to Europe. I have been listening, and there are many speakers, they have been discussing the problems of Europe, and they are very much emphasizing on the cultural diplomacy and also emphasizing on the solution of migrants, that how they are causing troubles and what should be dealt with that. But nobody has talked about the peace building process between the West and between the East, or between the developed countries and developing countries. Very less is added, or very less is invested in third world countries or developing countries in institutionalization and also peace building and many other processes, which human rights somehow expect that. By the makeup of UN, European Union, or Shanghai Cooperation, UN is getting weaker. And the more the UN gets weaker, the more the other institutionalization gets bigger and stronger. I think polarization in the world becomes much more clear. And this polarization will cause, again, World War III, IV, V during 21st century. Can we think rationally that how to solve this problem of envision of stronger countries to smaller countries? Why nation goes to war also talks about the causes of war. The biggest cause of the war, as you were also prime minister, the biggest cause of war was personalities. Wars were not caused by economic searches or any other ideologies or even civilization or religions. It was caused because of there were personalities that they needed wars for their own ego. And still we can see that ego is enlarging in Europe and also in Western. Thank you so much.
Well, let's not generalize. There are the reason for migration of large numbers of people varies. It's not always war. Climate change, for example. We have seen the mass movement of people from certain parts of the African continent because of drought. Because the families in those countries were unable to make a living, and they had to move from one continent to another. There are mass movements of millions of people because of economic reasons. If you go to the Caribbean and the United States with Mexico, you will understand that the mass movement there is also mostly for economic reasons. What I find frustrating, just to turn it upside down a little bit, is that very often we are unable to make the argument. Okay, so we have the problem of lack of integration. There's the issue of integrating a community within a community is an enormous challenge, and there are these cultural challenges. But there is also the argument that we fail to make to our own people that the presence of migrants in our societies and communities is also necessary for economic reasons. I'll give you a few examples. If you come to my country, I can tell you in Malta, small island, okay, but 70% of the workers in the construction industry are migrants. If they had to leave tomorrow, we would have a crisis in our construction industry. We would have to import labor, pay them God knows what salaries, the cost of labor would go sky high, and we would create a whole economic earthquake. I'll give you another example. The presence of migrants in the caring professions. Tell me how many families you know that have people from the Philippines who are qualified nurses who have traveled to Europe and are providing an excellent service within our communities. But they are migrants as well, and they are important. If they had to go back, I can guarantee you, even in the UK, half of their hospitals would end up without nurses. The half of their health system would collapse because they would not have anyone who would... There are so many other areas. I can give you another example. Look at the environment. And when I say the environment, I'm talking all the industry that has to do with cleaning, etc. It is necessary. It is funded. It goes on because of the presence of migrants. You know, and so what we are failing to do is explain enough about the benefits that this is bringing to our society. And I make this point only to answer the point that you make, because we should never resign ourselves to the fact that the migration is only the result of wars. Migration is the result of wars as well. Large numbers of refugees from Syria because of the disaster that has taken place in Syria, with enormous lessons that the international community should take from that experience as well. But that's the result of war. There is where solidarity needs to come up. There is where we need to come up with solutions. But my point is this. There's so many arguments that we fail to put forward to our electorate in order to make the argument. Sometimes I get the impression that we're giving up. Sometimes I get the impression that politicians are afraid to make this argument. because it is not a popular argument to do. The politician is afraid of losing his seat in parliament, his comfortable seat, his or her comfortable seat in parliament, because the argument to justify migration and integration of migrants in our community is a scary one. You know, it's a scary, it's not a popular one. And therefore what happens is we go along with the flow of the current of the public opinion out there, which means that we have a big failure in leadership. Politics is a call for people to lead. It is not a call for people to be led. I would never enter politics simply to do what somebody else out there who is shouting tells me to do. I enter in politics because I have my values, I believe in them, I try to persuade people to do it, and then if I'm not chosen, then thank you so much, I'll go back and do my normal work. So that's it, thank you.